some slides. 1 second. Okay. Okay. I will present this paper that is, I think, a quite not really academic. It's a quite rare paper that we call the 7 Sins of Standardized Management System. I have written together with Professor Franceschini and Professor Mastro Giacomo in the Politecnico of Torino. It's still not published. That basically what we're trying to do is to relate the 7 sins of the Catholic Christian teachings to Alanya to see which parallels there is with the risk of implementing standardized management systems. So I'm going one by one. I give you some shots in the 7 minutes, 1 minute for each one, in order to take some one idea of our paper. First of all, it's about pride. As you know, pride is a personality trait that consists of complacency in the own merits compared to those from others. And I think it's very related to the fact to use this recognition to after one of the implementation of management system as a marketing tool, and not as a management system for the continuous improvement. In fact, there are many papers from 1995, which one first from Taylor, that the motivation for implementing management system is the customer pressure, the marketing advantage, but there is also other papers about which are the benefits. And many, there is one very famous one from Battle in 1997, which talks again that the most valid benefits, they are the ones related to the improvement of marketing benefits. In fact, in the own definition of ISO 9001, you can see that one of the abilities of this standard is to demonstrate and to have some kind of marketing rules. And I think that this is not a problem. This is not, in fact, a big problem. We have to consider that it's not reached to some kind of, let's say, arrogance. Let's go for the second one, that it's MB. Well, if we focus on the process approach, that it's related to the standards. Well, you know that you have to define the strategical, tactical, operational process, and so on. But one of the most the big problems that we can find is that sometimes there's a deficient assignment of responsibilities in the management systems, which is the process, which are the tasks that we have to do. It's the problems with we need a core assignment of responsibility, and sometimes they are not assigned because we don't have some of the processes, they are not assigned to any of the person. Others, they are assigned to 2 different persons. Other ones, they are assigned to different persons who doesn't know who has to do. So in these aspects that we can consider that MB could be one of the how to implement better one of the management system. Next one, it's about growth. That's, let's say, ira. It's an uncontrolled excessive feeling of rage or anger. And well, this is very clear that it's the increasing of bureaucratization that all the management systems, all the people talk about, that sometimes leads to growth in everything that refers to management systems. So it's obviously that we have to define a policy, internal, external audits, risk analysis, and so on, a lot of documentation that sometimes is often perceived as not contributed to equality. In fact, sometimes even the process related to the quality of the products, like inspections, process control, metrology, they go to the same direction. And this is one of the main problems that all the people who are working in quality management system or management system in general, we have to afford that. So of the other rest of the people has ira, let's say, against ourselves or our work. A sloth refers to the negligence of careless of the things that you are forced to do. And I think that there is also many other papers about the problems that we can have when implementing a system is reducing the capacity of the innovation. Because we are feeling better to follow always the same rules, always the same processes. It's difficult to change, and it's difficult to innovate. So we have to focus on some kind of trade-off, let's say, between innovation and standardization. There are many papers that are in favor of that, they said, but there are other papers that are not. I think that maybe one of the more important ones, one from Bosic, that said that what is more important is the maturity of the system that could be the more related to the, what we expect from that. Number six is greed. It's codicia, is applied to the terms of excess desire of perceived health, as stand and power. Well, it's the fact to, that many of the systems, they are victim of the people who are involved in that. There are also paper on that. So what I mean is that this is the vision of the advisors, consultants, quality management, the ones who are designing the systems that sometimes they are not so useful for the same company that they are implemented. So we can have systems very, very soft because they are not implemented for the specific company, and some others they are very, very specific or very hard because there's some idea of this consultant, of these people who is implementing, and this is not exactly related to the standard. Next one is gluttony, and I will relate that to the excessive appetite for standardization of everything. It's impossible to have a management system without including policies, procedures, instructions, indicators. But that doesn't mean that not all the management systems, they are also homogeneous. Sometimes they are with more processes, more indications, more goals, more meat. We like to standardize everything, and this is, could be one of the other risks of the standardization of the system. And last one, in just half a minute, is, I would like to say, last. It's very difficult to link last to one of the risks, but it's clear that, for instance, that many organizations that implemented the standards that maybe they are not needed. They are implementing standards, for instance, ISO 14001 about environmental management system, when they don't have many impact in the environmental. So they just implement more and more standards. But at the same time, if you follow the standards that ISO is defining, sometimes there are some of the standards that are quite strange, maybe not very useful. For instance, ISO 20700 about providing guidelines for the effective delivery of management consultant service. I don't know how many consultant services that implement these standards because there is no certification about that. But sometimes we have the feeling that these are superfluous and we are being some kind of creation of not useful for somebody. So we have both of them, more standards, and other times companies implementing standards that are not useful for them. I will leave it here. Thank you very much. I think it's just the 7 minutes that I have. Thank you.
That's brilliant. Thank you, Marty. That's a wonderful time, a very insightful and enjoyable presentation. So thank you. We're now going to move to the UK, and I'm going to introduce Jon Murthy. He is has worked in standards and supply chain quality assurance for the last 20 years. His work has focused on communicating the value of globally recognized standards in order to promote their uptake in the food and consumer product sector. Jon currently works for LGC ASSURE, a newly established brand that offers a connected suite of solutions that intelligently analyze the safety, quality, and authenticity of goods and services, alongside evolving value drivers such as health, environmental, human welfare, and ethical impact. And prior to that, Jon worked for BRCGS, UCAS, and the BBC. So a very varied background. So over to you. Thank you for joining us, Jon.
Thank you, Helen, and afternoon, everybody. Let me just share my screen. How do I follow the seven deadly sins of management systems? Honestly, I hope you can see my slides now. Let me just put it in there. Seven deadly sins, the marketing one, I certainly agree with. Gluttony and lust, goodness me. So what I will do is give you a brief introduction to standards, how they came about, and then sort of pose some questions about where I think they're going so that they really truly add value. How they came around, if you just, I could have taken any lasagna or any ready meal that you find in supermarkets, but this one's chicken Kiev as an example. the supply chain is long and it's complex. Just in this one ready meal, you've got ingredients from 17 different that are handled in 17 different processes that originate from 11 different countries across four continents. I think same for frozen pizza, same for lasagna. It's a complex network of processing, distribution, storage, and then ultimately retail. So that's where standards came around. And about 25 years ago, all the retailers, all the big brands, whether they be big manufacturers like Nestle through to supermarkets like Asda or Sainsbury's in the UK, did their own audits. So they audited their suppliers. So a supplier could be providing products to multiple retailers and were therefore subject to multiple audits. So what evolved was a set of consensual standards provided by certification program owners, as they're known, of which BRCGS were one. A lot of acronyms in my introduction. BRC originated from the British Retail Consortium. So a group of supermarkets got together, developed a set of consensual standards, so a supplier was subject to one audit. And where we are now is that there are approximately 200,000 sites, manufacturing sites, processors, distribution organizations in the food sector that are certified now, covering about $2.3 trillion worth of retail sales. That's about a fifth of total retail sales. Now, that system exists, but do these standards do any good? I mean, clearly, having one audit instead of multiple audits, you know, what Monday would be Waitrose, Tuesday would be Sainsbury's, you cut that out to the most part. But do they add any value before that? And until recently, and this is a teaser for Marion's presentation coming up, there was very little data in the food sector to show that they actually provided any operational or business benefits. We've got some individual case studies that show some benefit on an individual sort of micro level. And we know as an industry within BRCGS, we correct about 185,000 major non-conformities every year. So they're corrected, which will have an impact on food safety. But there's a real lack of published data until now. And the report on the right is a prelude to Marion's presentation in a minute. But just picking up Marty's point around standardization impacting on innovation, doing it all the same way. One of the findings was very surprising, actually, that it did stimulate innovation. We can either come on to that in the questions or Marion, I'm sure, will cover it. Having said all that, there are limitations with standards. If you consider the performance of a site will vary over time. So at the point of the audit in 1st of June, when a BRCGS auditor goes in, they could well be performing very well and be rated as an A class site. But when the brand goes in to do its spot checks or a second party audit 15 days later, there could be a variance. And that does happen across many brands. So it's a point in time, once every 12 months audit. It doesn't provide a true picture over time. The second area, you won't be able to read all the writing on there, but the point is that if you do an industry comparison to what they spend on compliance, if you look at medical device sector, automotive, aerospace, etc., they spend a lot more in relation to total retail sales on compliance, whether it's testing, inspection, certification, than they do in the food sector. And there are a number by multiplier, actually, in terms of illnesses and unavoidable deaths that are caused in the food sector through a lack of compliance. So there's a gap that is there. And then the final point is we in consumers, in many economies, developed economies primarily, but we're changing our habits towards what influences in what we buy. Quality is a given, it's a non-negotiable given in the products and services we buy, but we're now starting to see are consumer decisions based on, is it produced ethically? Does it have a negative impact on the environment? Is it produced locally, etc.? Now, how can standards, and just leaving you with a question, how can standards, or in an area where there's a lack of regulation, how can the market prove that what we buy meets the expectations that we place on it? So thanks for your time and look forward to speaking you in the question and answers.
Thank you. Very interesting and beautifully illustrated. We're doing well with the pictures today. We're telling lots of stories. So thank you for that. And I think this leads on very nicely to the next speaker, Jacob Mogensen, who's head of incubation entrepreneurship in the food and bioplasma in Denmark. So Jacob has more than 13 years experience of facilitating and assisting startups, which will be the focus of his talk, and small and medium-sized enterprises, and picking up on the theme of innovation, supporting their capacity to develop innovative products and concepts. And so he's often dealt with the positive and negative sides of having standards. Again, picking up a point that was made by John, and especially the last couple of years with the sustained focus on sustainable and climate-friendly solutions. Again, I think the narrative continues very nicely into this presentation. So over to you, Jacobs, and thank you for joining us.
Well, thank you, Helen, and thank you so much for giving me this opportunity to be part of this event. I've now shared my screen. I hope you can see it. I'll do like this. A some way more practical approach to my 7 minutes here. Rightly said, my name is Jacob, and I'm from the Food and Biocluster Denmark, and just 30 seconds on that. That is the officially appointed cluster for developing the food and bio industries in Denmark, meaning that we got a public grant and the license to operate within this area from the government, but also from our 360 members. We are a relatively large corporation within this field of activities, more than 40 employees for now, and we have a portfolio of different kind of activities, including a lot of EU-funded projects for more than 150 million euros. We host ourselves 150 events a year, and we are located 10 different places across Denmark, even though Denmark is a very small country. But that is, of course, we have to be very close to our members and the companies in Denmark, so we know what's going on. We cover the entire food chain, everything from the field and farm to what's served on a Michelin restaurant in Denmark or elsewhere, and the side streams back. Well, my takeaway message is that regulations, from my point of view, and standards especially, are drivers for innovation. We've seen that for the last 15, even more years here in Denmark. How standards, sometimes alone, but also standards in together with different kinds of regulations, have developed new technologies that then have been the driver for companies and even transitions in industries. We've seen that we have grown in Denmark new industries that are now the fairy tale of income for Danes, you know, and we have also seen that we can create a lot of jobs and growth potential because we actually have dealt with these standards and issues a long time ahead. Of course, it has been a reason for many frustrations, especially in startups and smaller companies that do not always have the time to cope with these different aspects of dealing with standards and the license to operate. Because for a startup, the difference between a regulatory or a law or a standard is not that big, because for them it is a license to operate, more or less. And therefore it's very crucial that they can fit into these standards. If I am to put it just a few words why we actually succeeded so well in Denmark, I think it is because of the very close and very dynamic cooperation between the public authorities, the private companies, and the academia, not at least, because it has been driven by politicians and very ambitious goals within the environmental, within the climate agenda. But of course, it has to be left by all of the stakeholders. a few examples of what we meet out there. You all know that we have a fairy tale of windmills, but do you also know that we have a the next stronghold is to become biogas? And why is that? Well, that's because actually it's a very good example of an industry developed on standards and in some sort of regulations and incentives. Back in the 90s, the start of the new century, there were some new laws from EU regulating how to treat waste. At the same time, we had a lot of cows, a lot of manure from pigs in Denmark, and we needed to find a new way to treat these waste streams. So the industry came together and set some standards and developed how the gas could be used, how the manure could be treated, the standards for different technological solutions so that they could fit together, so that not one company had to develop everything, but the companies could work together. Today we see that we are now opening new markets in France, in Spain, but also in the US right now. We just had a delegation a couple of weeks ago in California, and we are now selling that equipment over there. And the Danish companies are receiving big orders from that. And it has all to do with this cooperation around standards and regulations 15, 20 years ago. But there are still issues because in Denmark, we have a lot of standards around organic waste and how to use waste. They are more or less based on the EU legislations, but we also have some voluntarily standards, especially within the organic waste streams. And one of the issues that we struggle with, it, and I have spent a lot of hours discussing with the startups, is, for instance, that we put a lot of effort, a lot of resources into producing new bio products, food, other bioproducts that are that have been organic produced. And the second that I have finished eating half of my sandwich or something else and I cannot eat anymore, the second I drop it into the garbage bin, it is no longer organic. Meaning that we cannot produce organic fertilizer, we cannot produce organic side streams or new waste streams from that organic material that could have the same value as the original organic produced. These are some of the standards and the regulatory that we are fighting with right now, because there is a need for producing more side streams, new products, new technologies, developing this, and we in order to fight the climate agenda and so on. But this is a good example of how standards can be a bit difficult to come around. Some of these new technologies is, among other things, also in the industrial production of insects. We've seen a lot of these cases around Europe, and now we also have seen a couple of cases here in Denmark. And some of the regulatory stuff around this area and the standards that have been developed for many years is a good example of how the industry and real life sometimes moves faster than the regulatory EU from EU and other places can follow. We've seen a lot of cases where we actually seen that the insects need some kind of biomass to grow on, and what we can feed the insects is regulated and standardized a lot. So actually the situation right now is that we can only use the feed that we normally use for other animals. And that was not the point of introducing insects into the agricultural sector, because we thought we could use it for making more value out of side streams. But this is a good example that also in terms of usage of the insects can be used in terms of food for some animals, but not all, because, and if we are to biorefine it, we cannot use we can use the whole insects in some ways, but not the refined insects in other areas, due to some standards that we have in different areas of the food chain, for instance, in the feeding industry. So here we are discussing a lot with the industry and a lot of with the authorities. How can we change, first of all, the standards voluntarily agreed upon by the industry, but also the laws? How can we use the standards to move the laws sometime? And just the last example of how we have actually done that before is this good example of this startup who had the idea that we had a standard of putting manure into the field in Denmark. We used these big spreading machines. But then a law was actually put on top of the standard on how to do it in Denmark. That you now have to put it into the ground in order to avoid emissions. But then this startup with the name Syrene, which is actually in Danish the name of acid and then nitrogen put together in Danish. He invented that we could just put on acid into the field on top of the manure as well, and then we could avoid the emissions that we wanted to avoid, but we could also avoid the new law because we could just then keep on working with the standards. And this is a good way of how entrepreneurs see standards and laws as drivers for innovative technologies. And this machinery is now driving around the entire Denmark, and is now a good example of how you can challenge both the law and standards sometimes. Yeah. I think that was my 7 minutes, and I look forward to taking questions. Thank you.
Yeah, that's a wonderful example. So thank you very much indeed. And we'll come back to those points later. So we're now turning to my very good colleague, Dr. Marion Frenz. She's a co-deputy director of the Centre for Innovation Management Research. Her research looks at business innovation, in particular, role of international linkages in innovation. She's also examined firms' innovation strategies during times of economic downturns, and she's worked very closely with Dr. Ray Lambert, who is our discussant today, and she's developed typologies of innovation modes or routines, including non-technological modes, and looked at the role of accreditation and standards in business performance. And you're going to talk about this consultancy project for this report just now that you've been doing, Marion. So over to you. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much, Helen, for the introduction. Much of the work I've been doing over the last 15 years, I think so now, has been with Ray, including the report I'm presenting today, which we wrote on behalf of BRCGS, so for John and his colleagues. The report is entitled The Economic Impact for, in this case, Food Manufacturing Sites Operating to BRCGS Certification. So BRCGS owns a set of food safety standards that were originally developed, as John said, by the British Retail Consortium, and I think the first standards were published around 1996. I'm going to say a few words which I think recap on what John said. Hopefully, it's adding, and I'm being accurate on this. So why do we have these private food quality and food safety standards? So some of the driving forces behind them are, well, of course, firstly and foremost, to keep us, the consumers, safe. By ensuring that the food we buy and we eat is safe. So high-profile food scares have put pressure on industry to act and develop, and then to continuously refine and improve food safety standards. And I'm just picking up on a current example that you might be aware about, and that's the case of salmonella that was found in baby milk formula only last month in the US, and that resulted in the suspension of production by the largest manufacturer of formula milk in the US, and actually sparked a nationwide shortage of baby formula. So that's just an example of how such incidences are very harmful and damaging for society and also for businesses. So how do food brands, so the selling to end consumers, ensure that the food they sell is safe? And as John said, the answer is to perform an audit. They audit their suppliers. So this audit of food manufacturing sites is costly, particularly because the industry works with multi-actor networks that can span multiple countries and continents, as we've seen in John's presentation. Now, these supply chains involve the food brands, the supermarkets, the food companies, restaurant chains, and these food brands buy from many food manufacturers, while food manufacturers potentially sell to multiple brands. So if everyone does their own audits, that is very costly for everyone involved. Therefore, this direct audit is supplemented and to some degree replaced with a third-party audit. And these third-party audits are carried out by independent auditors, by certification bodies, and the certification bodies, they check that manufacturing sites comply with a specific food safety standard. So the food brands then state their requirements, which safety standards they accept and their suppliers must meet. Then this third-party assurance system has the potential to bring down, to reduce the audit burden for both the brands and for the food manufacturing sites. What it also does is it signals and spreads best practice within the industry and the sector. Now, the main aim of food safety standards is to ensure that the food is safe. But in our report, we looked beyond it also at the economic impacts. So that's the operational and financial outcomes of certification to a standard for the food manufacturing businesses. So the existing empirical evidence from food standards is extremely scarce. So we could only find very few studies, and these studies typically work with very small sample sizes in the evidence gathering. So within those studies, there was a comparatively good coverage on the motivations, on the challenges and costs of certification for manufacturing sites. And there was relatively less and also less agreement on the outcomes, both the financial and the operational. And we didn't find a study that linked food safety standards to innovation. And this is the gap that we've tried to fill within the report by looking at financial impact and impact on innovation and modernizing. And that I'm going to pick up in the presentation. So the data that I'm presenting from, and that's presented in the report, is based on BRCGS standards. The BRCGS scheme is the largest scheme. It's based in the UK. The standards are used by 30,000 sites worldwide. And we've designed our own survey that was distributed via BRCGS to those 30,000 sites. We've received some 640 responses to the questionnaire. So I'm only going to share basic descriptive results with you and results on the impact of standards on business operations and on business performance in this talk, in the presentation. So on the right bar here, you see agreement of the businesses with improved product quality as a result of certification to food safety standards. Now, as you would expect, there's a high level of agreement, but not a complete agreement. So this agreement is even higher on improved product safety, where around 80% of sites agreed and 5% disagreed. So this is the main aim of the standards, the product safety. In terms of wider operations, there's been agreement in our data that certification to a standard has led to better training of staff. So this is shown here in the left bar. So the green indicates agreement and the red indicates disagreement. Yellow is neutral. Looking more on the side of innovation and modernizing in this slide, there's then also agreement that certification has led to improvements in the organization of production. That has led to investment in technology, and ultimately that this is feeding through to some innovation. So that's the right bar. On the innovation, we've got 30% of sites agreed that certification has led to an increase in product innovation. Now, bearing in mind that the aim of the standard is to increase product safety, not as such innovation, it's interesting to see that also on average, there's some agreement and increase of innovation outcomes. So in itself, we think this is a finding not previously reported elsewhere. Although there is a more general literature on the impact of technical standards and innovation, which implies this relationship too. This slide now presents summary results from a numerical question in which we asked sites to estimate the percentage changes in both sales and profits that they attributed to certification. So the profits are in red, orange, and the sales are in blue. So around 30% of respondents estimated that there was an increase in sales and in profits. Another 30% estimated no change. A further 30% didn't know, they're not visible in the slide, they didn't answer the question as such. And the remaining 5 to 10% of businesses suggested a negative impact. Now, using midpoints in our data, there is on average, a 7.5% sales growth and a 6% profitability growth reported by our data. If we look at competitiveness and market access, the data suggests that on average, 50% or more of businesses agreed with an increase in competitiveness and market access due to certification. And as you can see from those bars, this is particularly pronounced in the export markets, which are the second and the fourth bar. This is my last slide, probably on my last minute. Some concluding remarks. So we think we added to the evidence base, especially on sites' performance effects with sales, profits, and innovation, and found a positive impact on market opportunities, especially in the export markets. And that's something that's also in line with research that we looked at using ISO 22000. Certification is positively linked with increased competitiveness, investment in training and skills, and modernizing and innovation. That is broadly in line with some findings and research on ISO management standards. So in the certification, what we found has a very widespread effect, reaching multiple aspects of the business operation and performance. So broader innovation that we looked at includes product innovation, investment in new technology, as well as changes in business processes and enhanced product quality, as well as enhanced product safety. Respondents to our survey also flagged challenges for businesses. And these are in particular the cost of the audits, cost of training staff. But what we found is that there is less agreement on potential resistance of employees to certification processes compared with what is responded elsewhere. So I'm going to leave it here and hand back to Helen.
Okay, thank you very much. That's wonderful data, Marion. That's really important to have that kind of data to inform policy and practice. So could I ask people to put questions in the chat? We're going to move to Ray now, who's going to be the discussant. But it would be useful if you could start to think about the questions to the panel. So I'm very pleased to introduce Ray. He's also a member of the CIMR family. He's had a long career as a civil servant economist working in several different departments. And for the last 18 years, he's worked on aspects of the economics of innovation and innovation policy, with special reference to metrics, indicators, and the modelling of innovation. And he's worked with Marion for quite a few years, as Marion suggested. So it's all wonderful work, and you're very well placed with your experience, Ray, to comment on the speakers. So over to you for your 7 minutes. So thank you.
Thank you, Kelly. Well, that was a very useful overview in those short papers of the issues surrounding standards, and particularly the impact on innovation, which has been our main focus. But running just very briefly through contributions, starting with Marty's point that you can over-standardize, and standards can be start to be seen as a crutch, a substitute for management. And so they have to be seen as a tool, an input, something that's used actively by management. And one thing that strikes me about some of the potential pitfalls is on management standards, which was Marty's subject, that the ISO management standards, ISO 9001, et cetera, series, are very generic. They're about how you manage anything. That takes me on to BRCGS and food standards, because those, of course, are very industry specific standards developed on the basis of the ISO series, but made very applicable to the food industry. And that gives them more immediate relevance and enhances the take up and benefits to the individual companies that can use them, because they can actually directly see the relevance rather than just going along with the gag, as it were. Interesting that John made the point that there's still a limited take-up of these food standards, so we still have sort of some major food safety issues. So this is not an area perhaps where there's over-standardization, possibly a degree of under-standardization as yet. But the following end, picking up Jan's point about the role of standards and the active use of the standards system in Denmark to promote startups and innovation and new solutions to climate impacts and environmental impacts. Again, these are being developed very specifically and with close involvement of the businesses concerned. And again, raises in my mind an issue about standards formation, because the typical ISO or national standards body process is getting lots and lots of experts from industry, users, academia, and so on around the table, arguing it all out and getting it written up, probably by the Secretariat. Whereas the BRCGS food standards model, and I think similarly for the other standards makers in this space, is that the standards are written by the staff of the standards owner, with some advisory boards, mainly in the case of food standards, from the user, the retailers and the catering industries, rather less from the supplier side. And one benefit of that, I guess, is that it's a much faster system. Now, I think BRCGS are on about the 8th or 9th review and new issue of their core food safety standard, and that's in about 20 years. I think you'd be lucky to get 2 or 3 iterations of an ISO committee standard in that sort of time scale. So there are advantages, but the breadth of consultation and involvement in the actual standards making process is a bit less. So there may be some trade-offs there that are worth thinking about. I think, again, following up Jan's point, read across quite nicely to our study, which quite surprisingly did show, apart from the other benefits, as Marion said, some pro-innovative impacts of taking up food safety standards, because it takes, I think, putting it crudely, it probably takes some pressures off of management about some things, they've got a standard for how to run the place safely, but they can think about what can we now do. And one of the bits of research, one of the things we found in talking to final users, big retailers, was that they could now focus their discussions with potential suppliers on how they can work together and perhaps get better products, rather than simply saying auditing them. So it's a basis for quality improvement as well as just meeting quality standards. So I think that's enough from me, and we should open the floor. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ray. That's very helpful. There is a comment in the chat from Eagle. I don't know whether you want to raise that point.
Hi, everyone. Yeah, thank you so much for the talk. That was extremely insightful. I'm in the financial services space and work with entrepreneurs quite a lot, so particularly Jacob's points where I could relate to very much too. I think Marion's answered my question around the data around certifications. In fact, I've seen something like that in my organization as well, where we've been looking at accreditations from various organizations, things like Ideas UK for innovation management. And what we've seen is that it's very, very helpful for some of the smaller companies, at least in financial services, which I know is a very different field. And just to add to the debate, that we've seen that regulation plays a massive impact in fueling innovation and competition, particularly open banking standards and the FCA. So thank you for the talk. And I could see it stimulated so many parallels within the industry that I work in, and it's been extremely interesting to hear about the food safety standards as well.
Thank you very much for that observation. And is this possible for you to get in touch with our speakers? And if you want to communicate directly with them, we can manage to introduce you to the people you want to speak to. So thank you. So can I ask the panel now to respond to that observation and to raise comments? Can we start with you, Marty? Having listened, you were on first, and now you've listened to everybody else. What are your reflections from
that? Yeah, well, my reflections, it's not about the question, or maybe more in general. I'm about this point about the innovation of the standards, the possibility to have more innovation when you are implementing different standards. This kind of trade-off. John has been talking about that, also Jacob. But I was very surprised for the survey of Marion, when there are 10% of people who disagree that the standards increase the product quality. And then there is also 10% of who is also disagree with the innovation of the product. And I was just thinking, well, supposing that the majority of the people who respond, they are the people who is more positive with the standards, then there's still more. So I can understand clearly that the people, it's neutral, but I cannot understand why that means they are disagreeing. My point of that is that, well, how could they disagree with the standard? Well, probably because the standard is not useful for them. Basically, it's just the cost, and this cost has to be involved directly to the product, and then the product is more costly. Okay, so it has to impact on some way. But I think that related to another point that John was in his last slide. His last slide in this model describes the transparency, and I think it's very, very important. This draw. My point is, maybe it's because the standards, basically what they are showing to us is continuous improvement. Basically, this is the main concept of many of the management standards. If this continuous improvement it seems another side of the same coin of the transparency, this is the problem, I think. If we are able to show that both are together, that with more transparency, you get more continuous improvement, but with more continuous improvement, you get more transparent, then probably we will avoid these people who is disagreeing, and then probably we will not be surprised with this data, and then probably we will follow increased innovation for small companies and for big companies. And for me, there is not much difference at all.
Thank you.
Sorry, maybe I mix everything, but it's just my.
Thank you, John. Do you want to come in now and reflect?
I just on the point of small companies and large companies, I've worked in accreditation across different industries, from healthcare to sustainability to manufacturing and now food. The accreditation and certification, I think, is more weighted towards helping small businesses because it becomes that license to operate and it becomes a great leveler. Large companies compete on their brand. They manage all the certification for it, and it's brand and heritage that is the point of difference for them. But for smaller companies, they get on the supplier lists through the accreditation, and therefore it's a leveler. I think on innovation, I think that was the thing that really surprised me. And I've seen this across different industries as well. Healthcare is a good example. Imaging in health, both private and public, in the UK, and the consensual standards are written, and where there is a gap, it becomes a leverage for investment. So the investment in expensive equipment or different ways of doing things or streamlining the process, which results in either product innovation or innovation in delivery of that. When Ray made the point to me, these standards were written around conformity and standardization, and safety was the aim, really. So it was surprising to see that there was innovation coming from these standards. But I think I'm still with my last three slides there. It's like this has been an evolution. We've now got to where the point of time on that day that organization was deemed compliant, whereas as you're saying, Marty, that greater transparency and that greater real-time assurance needs to come from the greater use of data, aggregating that data, whether it's internal data or external data sets that can predict, you know, supply chain disruptions or potential issues in labour shortages or weather, and then presented in a meaningful way that a brand and ultimately us as consumers can interpret that data to understand where the current risk lies and where future risk may occur. And that's a whole set of data, whether it's cultural, you know, you can have the standard, but do the people on the factory floor really believe in it? What are their behaviours like? That influences safety. There's environmental data, ethical data, right the way down to the supply chain. And if you look, just one last quick point, if you look at supermarkets, for example, now, their zero emissions targets are all on their own estates. They're not on the supply chain, and that's where probably 95% of the impact happens. And there's no current system, verified system, where you can look at the impact of a particular product. So.
Thank you. Yeah, terrific. It's good that each of you are picking up on the other points. Jacob, would you like to come in now and what struck you from what you've heard from other people?
Yeah, first of all, I really like the facts showing in the last presentation on the effects on innovation. I'm looking forward to following up on that. Just a remark on if standards can why some maybe believe that standards limit innovation or product development. We've been working together with the traditional oil industry promoting biodiesel, and when you produce biodiesel you introduce it to the filling stations out in the real world, you actually mix it with 99% of fossil fuels and 1-5% biodiesel, and the mixed product have to live up to a European standard, the EN590 standard, that actually describes the final product, how it should what it should be like. And what we experienced was that the biodiesel itself was actually better than the standard. So what the oil industry then did was that they took a poorer product to mix with the biodiesel product, so that the standard was just fulfilled at the ground zero still. So coming in with new products, new technologies, better solutions, actually, that's just, I'm just thinking, why would the fact that you shown, Marty, just my reflection on that, this is an example of how the standard actually works the opposite way around, because you have a standard that you have to live up to, and this is, like said before, it's the license to operate, and you just have to fulfill that. Anything better than that is just waste of money if you can actually make money on making the standard or the product poorer. So that was just an reflection. I started wondering what an example of that. But apart from that, I have not that much to add.
Okay, well, that's great. Marion, if you'd like to reflect, and then we have a question from Darren. But Marion, what have you heard?
I can't really add anything to what the experts, both Jacob and John, have, you know, on based on their experience, have added to the discussion. I think I'll because working with the data, I'll often look at the aggregate, so the more high level picture. I think the observation that Ray made about differences in standard development, I think it's a really good one, and the difference between the management standards and the more specific standards, and also the way that, yeah, the food safety standards are being continuously revised and improved upon much faster in the standard formation. I think it's a good point. I wanted to say that, of course, I've only picked out very small details from this report for this presentation in the 7 minutes. And like Marty, I think we've made available, and also Jacob made available our reports, or we will make them available on the CIMR website later on. So I'll be really happy to look into some of the details. And I think here the comment on the size of the firm helped me a lot to show that there's more to it. So we've sliced the samples into different businesses, into geographical region, and into firm size. So there's more to look at. And it's been really insightful to hear from the experts, also from the standards in finance. So thank you for that.
We're going to run out of time very soon now. We have a questions from Darren. If you could look at those, should we view standards as a target and destination or a journey against the opportunity for improvement? On a related note, constraints seem to often focus the mind, encourage a rethink of approach and perspective, and do standards achieve the same? So we'll have that question. And then there's another comment in the chat from Marcos about standards as accumulated knowledge, and that's quite a long comment there. If you can read those, but Nicoletta, would you like to ask your question? And we will, if you can reflect on the comments from Darren, the comments from Marcos, and from Nicoletta, and then we will close. So over to you, Nicoletta. Thank you.
Thank you very much. First of all, very interesting in terms of like all the different aspects that were covered. My question was in particular for Jacob and John, but of course for the whole panel. So I've been doing some research in retailing and food service, but also some research on innovation in Spain. Well, I had a lot of questions that came to mind, but one in particular was about when, for example, if there were any data on choosing a particular supplier for own-branded products from retailers, and what is the role of having accreditation and having met standards in terms of like the selection that retailers may do in terms of having those suppliers, because maybe that is an aspect that could help also some small medium-sized enterprises not only to enter in terms of having their products on the shelves, but also in terms of working with the retailers. And at the same time, also with the food service sector that Jacob mentioned in terms of like being part of what they are looking at. Thank you.
Oh, you're on mute. You're on mute. Shall I just answer? I think if I've understood the question correctly, we do a lot of work with suppliers. When they become certified, they appear on our directory, which is a publicly available website that suppliers use to select their suppliers. But we provide a BI, a business intelligence layer over the top, where they can look into greater detail around their audit. So retailers have got that insight, if you like, into trends over time or where the areas of potential weaknesses are by geography. So that's one way that can help suppliers get on within that shop window. The second thing we've done recently, it's ongoing actually, is to work with big brands to upskill their suppliers. So Ahold Delhaize is a big Dutch multinational food company. They're working with food suppliers in Romania and Indonesia, who are very small companies, single sites, but they want a minimum level of food safety and ethical behavior too. And they wanted to combine the two. And we worked with them on a particular project to get 20 or 30 of these suppliers up to a minimum level, who are now supplying off to other supermarkets like Metro and other. So they've grown their market and it's worked both ways. The retailer has confidence in it and vice versa. So I hope that answers the question.
Yes, great. Thank you very much. So it's not only UK based, but also international. OK, yeah. Thank you.
We've got three minutes left. Is there somebody on the panel that would like to reply to the other comments in the chat?
If you can respond
to everybody, and then you will be the last person before we thank everybody. So thank you, Marty. I'm sorry we've run out of
time. I think it's very interesting, this one about if the standard is a target or a destination. So I think that clearly it's a target, but if the standard is right and the implementation is right, has to be the destination, the journey, let's say. And at least for the ISO standards, we have get a very important change during the last years. And now all the standards, not only the general standards or the specific standards, but also the what I call the augmenting standards. That's called, for instance, 10,001, 10,002. It's standards for complaints, for code of conduct. All these standards, they are not just a target. They are clearly righted for clearly to have a good opportunity and to go for a continuous improvement for the future. So my point is, I think that now the standards, they are right. Now we need that the implementation is also right, because we again could do very wrong implementations with standards. This is my comment to the first question. I don't know for the others.
Thank you. The downside of these is that towards the end, people get excited and want to ask questions, and we always run out of time. But what we've done is recorded the questions in the chat, and maybe we can put to them and build them into the blog at the end, so we don't lose these valuable comments and questions, but we can reflect on them when we write up what has been a very exciting discussion today. Lots of listening, lots of engaging with people on the panel and with the audience. So I'd like to thank all of you for speaking, and thank you all for doing the work, and thank you everybody for joining us for this debate. So thank you everybody. It's been wonderful. So thank you and goodbye.
Thank you very much.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thanks all of you.